was coming from the dashboard of the car. I'd been hurtling down an exit ramp at 70 miles an hour when I hit a curb and ran off an embankment. This brought me to a sudden stop. I closed my eyes, assuming I was dead. Then I opened them, saw the smoke, and thought, oh my God, the car's on fire. I'd better get out of here. Opening the door, I fumbled for the seatbelt. That's when I heard the man's voice. Don't get out of the car, ma'am, he said. As if reading my mind, he added, the car's not on fire. That smoke is coming from the electrical system. His voice was pleasant, but apartheid. Don't move any more than you have to, he went on. You may be hurt, and if you move around, you could hurt yourself worse. This made sense, but I'm so uncomfortable, I couldn't keep from squirming. Still, I managed not to turn my head, so I didn't see what the man looked like. I called 911, and an ambulance is on the way, he said reassuringly. Try not to move until it gets here. At that point, my handbag fell out the open door of the car. He picked it up, read the name of my driver's license, then handed it back to me. What happened, Mrs. Austin? He asked. It was the last day of February, 1997. I was driving from Little Rock to Jackson, Mississippi. I got as far as Pine Bluff. They were working on the interstate highway that would bypass the city, and I was headed straight for an unfinished overpass, cruise control 770. Taking the last exit before the main road disappeared, I tapped on the brake. Nothing happened. I pressed down firmly. Still nothing. I was just yards away from two cars stopped at a red light. When, both feet on the brake, I swerved into a turn lane and went through the red light across four traffic lanes and up that embankment. I related this story to the man. He said something like, that was quick thinking. Well, it sure didn't take as long to happen as it takes to tell about it. Just then we heard the siren. Help was on the way, but the sound seemed to be coming from several different directions. What are they doing, I asked. Circling the land? I was trying to maintain my sense of humor. They probably want to get as close to the car as possible, said the man I now thought of as my friend. So they won't have to move you very far to the ambulance. All this time, people had been wandering over wanting to find out what happened. A policeman questioned several of them, including my friend. Then he gave me a ticket for being out of control of my car. By this time, I was shaking too hard to write my name, so I just signed it with an X. The ambulance had finally pulled up, and my friend told the driver my story. Mrs. Austin, he said, we're going to take you to Jefferson Regional Hospital. Just lie still as you can while we ease you onto a stretcher. That was the last I saw of my friend. At Jefferson Regional, they did x-rays, and the ER doctor told me I'd broken my back. Then there was another ambulance ride to St. Vincent's in Little Rock, followed by surgery the next day. After about a week at St. Vincent's, I was transferred to Baptist Rehab for another 10 days. I got home from the hospital on one of those beautiful, mild, sunshiny days we sometimes get in March. Sitting on the deck of my house, I said aloud, to whomever it might concern, life is such a gift. And I thought about my friend. What would have happened that day if he hadn't shown up? I would almost certainly have tried to wriggle out of the car, which, as he explained, could have made a bad situation worse. The surgeon who pieced my first lumbar vertebra back together told me I'd been within millimeters of being paralyzed. I could so easily have pushed myself over the edge. Summons to appear at Pine Bluff Traffic Court came in the mail. So I had to know that I could just opt to pay my ticket. The attached police report gave the names and addresses of two witnesses to my crime, being out of control of my car. Wondering if either of the witnesses was my friend, I got phone numbers from directory assistance. But when I talked to them, they both turned out to have just been driving by. I haven't told this story to very many people. You might say I held it close to my heart. The first person to hear it was a clergyman who came to see me in the hospital. He beamed at me. "An angel," he said. After I got home, I shared